Welcome to the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast.
People not letting people in. People not just going the same speed. Everyone has to rush around everyone. It's those people that make traffic. That it's like, oh shoot, I have to exit here.
People like you and me.
And then...
We all do it. We're all part of it.
I know.
What's crazy is they did an observation where they looked at like big stretches of highway, busy highways. Like the 401 is the busiest highway in North, one of the busiest highways in the world.
It's not the busiest in North America. It's top four.
I'm pretty sure it's the busiest.
I don't know about that. But it's top four.
But it's definitely one of them. And so they observed like a highway like that, and they would see where someone would like veer off or like cut off like too much or whatever, and they would see the ripples.
Yeah.
Go like 15 kilometers back.
Oh, yeah.
So they made this program.
If someone stops there for 1 second.
There's a website where you can do it. You can, it'll just like slow one car down like 100 kilometers down the way. And that ripple just through all the cars behind it. And that's happening all the time. Ripples like
people
that.
People are being dumb drivers.
People are being selfish.
Selfish drivers. I always scream. Tell you, ask Jess. When I'm in the car, the number one thing I scream the most is... Plan your route. Plan your route. Jess will tell me. I am such a route planner.
You're the nicest road
ranger.
Hey,
buddy, plan your route.
Be responsible.
Seriously, though. Because if I know I'm exiting in 5 kilometers, I don't care how slow my lane's going. I am staying in that right line till I exit. Because I know... Like, my dad...
That's kind of you.
My dad, it'll be like... GPS will be like, 500 meters till we exit. We will be in the furthest carpool lane. And it'll be like that. And I am stressed out. And Jess is sometimes too. And she'll get so mad, I'll go like, hey, get in the right lane. And she's like, what do you mean? I'm like, well, we're turning right. She's like, yeah, in like a kilometer. I'm like, yeah, but right now there's an open space. Why wait?
The world needs more people like you, Luke.
I know. Welcome to the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast.
We're glad that you tuned in on this lovely day.
If you didn't know who I am, I'm Luke.
And I'm Jake.
Yes.
Well, if it's not a lovely day, it is now.
It is now, because you're listening to the... You're with us on the... We should have a calming presence.
Yeah, we should go... We're too loud, we're too quiet and too loud. We should always be like NPR.
They're like, welcome. We're so glad you could join us.
Welcome to
the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast.
Welcome to the TED Radio Hour.
I'm Guy Ross.
Yeah.
Computers. But, yeah.
Yeah. Today, we're excited. I'm excited.
I'm really excited. I mean, when we were putting together this episode, a few times I was like, Oh!
It's gonna be good! It's gonna be good!
But before we get to that, I guess they know it's in the title, but what have you been watching?
What have I been watching? So this is going to be... This may spark some controversy between the two of us. Because I watched a movie that I thought was a piece of crap that I think
you
like.
Think.
No.
No, you actually think this was.
I think it's a piece of crap.
But for what reason?
And I've never seen it.
Explain what the reasons are before you tell me what it is.
It's just a bad movie.
What's bad about it?
With a good performance. The script is so predictable.
Oh, no. I think I know what it is.
What?
Is it a foreign film?
No, it's not
a foreign film. Oh, okay. I thought it was going to be Livia Rose.
No. It's A History of Violence.
You don't like that movie?
I think it's a bad movie.
I don't think it's bad. I don't think it's great. I think Eastern Promises is way
better.
Eastern
Promises was great. I put on History of Violence, and I was sitting there being like, okay.
It's so...
They're building up, yeah. And then I was like, oh, this is cool. And then it got bad. Then it turned like bad movie.
I appreciate it for a few reasons, but I agree. I don't think it's that great.
No, I think it
fails. Oh, you made me nervous.
Yeah.
I can tell you were nervous. There's going to be like a friendship ending movie one day.
Yeah.
Like, what if I watch Sully and I think it's the best movie of last year? It's over.
Then you're
it's
not
over.
My friend anymore.
Exactly.
Like Max isn't my friend anymore either. And you know what? I intentionally didn't bring it up when he was here.
Yeah.
Because I didn't even want to open that can.
It would have been bad.
Yeah. Someone's calling me.
Our first caller of the show.
On the
Thank
podcast.
You for tuning in.
I have to answer. I don't know who it is.
Okay.
Hello? Hi. I'm good. How are you?
You just hung up on them.
Yeah.
Info, what is it?
I don't know. Hi, I'm Eddie from Dutch Cleaning Services. I don't need
your Dutch cleaning.
I take a shower once a week. What type? I should ask.
Dutch cleaning.
What type of cleaner are we talking about?
What kind of? Yeah. Deep cleaning. Deep cleaning.
You know, I have mad respect for those people, but I don't really. But
I don't have any respect for them.
That's got to be the worst job.
Certainly a demoralizing job, but after a while, you probably are just like, okay, next one.
I had the worst job. Selling credit cards at a gas station.
That's bottom feeder type job.
That's the worst.
That's really bad.
People don't want to sign up for a credit card as soon as they put at a gas station.
And the kinds of people that are more victims.
Yeah. You know what would be the worst?
What?
Selling credit cards at a funeral home.
Oh. You can get anything you want on the TV. Anything you see.
Could you imagine? Oh, I'm sorry for your loss. By the way, there's it's completely free. It's there the Taylor just, they funeral
just lied.
Home.
They just lie to old people.
Oh, I know. My friend Chad worked for the place I worked for, and he got like let go because he was people he called was in and abusive? Said no. He lied because there are certain things we're not allowed. We have to tell them if they ask.
You
we
have
don't.
To be honest.
We say card
legally. You have
but
to
if say. They say, "Is this a credit card?" You go, "Yes." Is it? Are they going to check? Am I going to get a credit check? Yes. Chad would go, "No, it's a points card."
Really? Just yeah. to get him to.
Just to get him to sign. People get a credit card in the mail, being like, "I just got a credit check."
That sucks.
They didn't tell me. Yeah.
So you watched The History of Violence?
Yes, that's what we're talking.
You didn't really
about.
Like it?
I thought it was a piece of poo. I really didn't like it.
Yeah, I can understand why.
Yeah.
Cronenberg is hit and miss. Like, he made that movie Map to the Stars, which was probably the worst movie I watched last year.
Really?
The stupidest yeah. thing I've ever seen.
Like, I always love. Like, he's a Canadian filmmaker, which is great.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, we, like, there's a lot of great Canadian filmmakers. With
there
him
are.
And Denis. Who's amazing.
He's the best, man.
But, yeah, I wasn't a fan. But then, I...
Isn't Jason Reitman Canadian?
Yes. Yeah, and Ivan, his dad, who made Ghostbusters.
Right, Ivan Reitman.
But it's funny. Jess likes to watch the Oscar movies after the Oscars are done.
Yeah.
So I, yesterday, 2 days ago, she was like, I'm in the mood to like watch something. Like, let's put on Manchester by the Sea. And I didn't know how she would feel about it because it can feel long. So I told her, like, if there's ever parts that it's slow.
It takes some time to get into like, it. It's a patient movie.
That wasn't the case. Like, within a minute, she was hooked.
Yeah.
Because the performance, it is inching up to my favorite performance of all time in a movie.
I could understand that. I could totally understand that.
As a contemporary film actor, because he, it is so bottled up, and it's always there.
Yeah.
Like, and you go back and watch the first scenes of people, it's there.
It's so good, man.
And when he says... There's nothing there.
There's nothing
there. To her.
There's nothing there.
There's nothing. Oh, and you know what part Jess started bawling at? When he grabs the gun and goes,
yeah,
please,
yeah.
Please.
Oh, that whole scene, when he's describing what happens, they said, okay, well, we got to let you go. And
he's
thinks,
like, what?
He thinks he's going to jail for the rest
which
of his life.
Which he wants.
Yeah. He wants to be punished.
Yeah. And him, remember in the theater, me and you were like,
oh, it was so tense, man.
It is intense. What have you been watching?
A few things. I watched, just today I finished a documentary about Hayao Miyazaki called Kingdoms of Dreams and Madness, who is like, he could be the greatest animation director of all time. And, like, his movies are Spirited Away, Howl's Moving Castle, Princess Mononoke, Nausicaa, Porco Rosso, Ponyo, and most recently, and what he says was his last movie, which is when they're making this documentary, The Wind Rises. And it's just the portrait of one of the most creative people on the planet. And how he works, and how he works with people, and how he sees the world. And he actually has quite a depressive view. But it's because he has a depressive view that he makes the movies he does. Because he says it's so important to deliver these kinds of feelings and deliver these kinds of stories to kids and to people because they need it, because this world is the way that it is. Mm. So it was just, it was inspiring. Yeah, I got emotional watching.
I bet any of those guys, John Lasseter, would say he's the best.
Yeah, but they all have crazy respect
for him. I watched a tour of John Lasseter's office last week, and it's all Miyazaki.
Yeah.
made by Miyazaki for John Lasseter. Like, certain artwork and stuff, because they're best friends. So, and I know they all regard him as the best. The best living, at
least. Dude, he's a master. Know. Yeah. Just the stuff he's done.
Your favorite of his is Princess Mononoke?
Probably. It's just, speaking of movie badasses, that movie has some of them in there. Not on my list, because there's too many others. But yeah, he's a master. I also watched Apocalypto again.
How was it?
The movie's so good, man.
It's
so simple, but it's so intense. It's so well made. I love it.
It seems like your type of movie.
Well, I literally, after I watched it, I googled movies like Apocalypto.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to see these, because
I know I'll see it and appreciate it, but I'm not going to go, I love Apocalypse.
No, man. Maybe. It's not what you think.
Yeah, okay.
It's really just three simple parts. And, like, there's, like, if you like the art direction and, like, the details of movies like Gladiator or Lord of the Rings, like, that sort of detail and art direction, it's all throughout there. If you really like, you know, a hero to root for and cheer for and, like, and also the historical significance of that time.
Like Rudy.
How it's represented.
I mean, like Air Bud?
It's so good. I also watched Prisoners.
Ah.
Which we've talked about at length. I rewatched The Assassination of Jesse James by the coward Robert Ford. We just put out a video about it.
You gotta watch it.
Your Heroes Are Dead. Check it out. And probably most interesting to our viewers at home is I saw with Max last weekend, Get Out. Which is a movie that has, I think it now has 99%.
That one reviewer was like,
and he's a terrible reviewer too.
Yeah.
He likes terrible movies. I look at his stuff. So 99%, Jordan Peele, who of Key and Peele, puts out this movie that,
horror movie.
It's a horror movie, but it has this perfect edge, this sort of ring around it, the whole thing, that it's very comedic. And that saves it from being torn apart by people who would be too harsh with any other horror movies. But also, it pays attention to the details of the story so well. It's just like, what a great script.
Was it great?
It was really good. It's really good.
Yeah.
It's a movie that, like, for me, I like bigger movies at times.
Yeah.
But this movie knew what it was. It stuck with it really well. There's a few nuanced things that was kind of like, okay, let's, like, keep moving. But
was
by
it scary?
By the end of it,
no.
It's more of a thriller.
Oh, cool.
But, like, by the end of it, you're cheering. The whole audience we were with, cheering and clapping at the end.
Really?
Yeah, and it's been a long time since that's happened in a theater for me. So that also elevated the whole experience. I think he says he has, like, 4 or 5 more of these, what he called, social horror movies.
Hmm.
And I would love to see more, because there's so much, he adds a lot of depth to it. Really clever stuff in there.
That's so awesome that he can make a movie like that.
For like $4.5 million, and it's now up to like $40 million. Yeah. So he'll probably make another 10 this weekend. Good for him.
Yeah.
I want to see more.
Yeah. They're funny, those guys.
Oh, Key and Peele are so good.
And then tonight, we're going to see Logan.
Yeah.
It just hit me that we're actually seeing Logan.
And we're seeing it in IMAX too. So you'll already see, our review is already, you can go find it. You'll already release, but I don't know. I know I'm going to love it.
Oh,
it's right
come
up my alley.
I'm going to love it. I love Hugh Jackman.
He's amazing.
First of all,
so lovable.
I think he is one of the best. Like, who doesn't like Hugh Jackman?
That's a good point.
He
super lovable.
Like, I've seen him in interviews being like, they're like, you're never in the tabloids, blah, blah, blah. He's like, you know what? He's like, after school, I pick up my kids, I go grocery shopping, I'm not trying to hide, and the paparazzi doesn't want to take pictures of me because I'm boring. He's like, I'm a dad. And it's true. He's such a dad, but he loves movies.
Yeah.
I can
tell. He's been in some great ones, and he's delivered a lot of great work. I mean, he was in Prisoners.
Yeah.
But with Logan, he's been playing Wolverine now for 16 years?
17
years. And this is his last movie doing it.
9 movies as this character.
Talk about a badass.
Yeah, Speaking of which. This week on the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast, we are counting down our top 10 badasses in film.
Oh, and there are so many. I think I have a list of 45.
Yeah.
That I narrowed down to 10. It was really
creating tough. This list was tough. But it's going to be interesting when we get into some that off the top of your head you wouldn't think. I don't know, for me, some of them people would go, really? Badass? And then they'd go, oh, you know what? Yeah, they're a badass.
And there's different kinds. There's like, different I think kinds. Some guys, you ask a certain guy, and he would just
Vin Diesel.
Off, he would just list off 10 action hero.
Well, I thought the typical badasses that you would ask the average moviegoer right now would be like Jason Statham, a transporter.
Sylvester Stallone.
Expendables. Sylvester Stallone, Rambo.
But no, those guys didn't even touch my list.
Me neither.
Because I think you need to be more than just muscles.
Yeah.
And like, there needs to be a different level in the psychology of a person.
Yeah.
There needs to be something where if you could imagine, and we'll be doing it later, different people head to head, that there would be no match because there's more going on.
But you got some of mine are the typical.
Yeah, I got a couple of those too.
Action. Like that, you're just like, you're so cool.
I got a few.
Like all of these get me so excited. And for those of you listening or those of you watching, if you haven't seen any of these movies that we're about to dive into, for some of my list, we've talked about them quite a few times, so.
Definitely on mine too.
Yeah. Okay, let's do this.
Let's do this thing! Let's
dive.
Okay.
Top 10 badasses by the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast. Shall I go
number
first?
Number 10, if you would.
Number 10. This is maybe controversial. All right? Number 10.
Buzz Lightyear. A Star Command.
I thought of Buzz. I thought of Buzz. She's a badass. I thought of Buzz.
Let's hear it. Number 10.
Rosamund Pike in Gone Girl.
Yeah.
As Amy.
Good choice.
Is a badass.
If you really think about it.
If you think about it. Okay, if you haven't seen Gone Girl, I'm going to spoil parts of it for you. But
well, yeah, by just saying that, you obviously have. Spoiler alert, Gone Girl. Go ahead.
Amy. Rosamund Pike, who plays Amy, is a badass. When you watch it from start to finish.
Scary.
Talk about getting back at a cheating husband.
Yes.
On a whole
most evil way possible.
Oh, genius. You know what? It wasn't even like, I didn't even think about her, but I wrote down Gone Girl because I was thinking about David Fincher and stuff like that, and I was like, oh my goodness. I'm like, that is crazy. Just thinking about her planning that whole end with Neil Patrick Harris.
And I was, the only thing is then people might say, well, she gets beat up, get robbed by those two people, and then what does she do? Then she slits Neil Patrick Harris's throat. That scene.
You know what's crazy? You know what I love? That scene when she runs to the window screaming.
Screaming, and she put like wine on her.
Yeah.
And the music, and you can't hear her screaming.
She's a badass.
That's a great choice.
Yeah.
I have a few choices similar to that as well.
Then I'll be like, whoa.
But my number 10, is, I think, this actor, I could have picked several of his roles, but I picked what I think is his most badass, and that's Jules from Pulp Fiction, played by Samuel L. Jackson.
Samuel Jackson!
Just for that scene in the diner, man.
Yeah.
Just for that
scene. He's such a badass.
If you haven't seen Pulp Fiction, do yourself a favor and just watch even just the first, like, 15 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Just to get that scene with him and John Travolta.
Yeah.
And when he starts quoting scripture. Now, it's not from the Bible at all. But right? That whole scene is not. He completely made it up.
I love it.
But that
and
scene.
The Lord.
And the Lord. Yeah. Strike. Or smack you. Oh. And his wallet, of course.
Oh, yeah.
And the whole ending scene in the diner. I mean, that's what a badass is. To be a badass, you have to be the kind of person who doesn't give a bleep. Like, you have to be a person who, it doesn't matter what's going on, you're focused and you're just.
And Tarantino, you gotta admit,
it's a bit of a pattern with my list.
Oh, really?
Apparently.
He set up Sam Jackson for greatness. For who he became.
Oh, yeah.
Sam Jackson wouldn't be anyone without
Quentin's words.
Because he made Sam Jackson that badass character that he went on to be a Jedi. He went on to be, to be Snakes on a Plane.
Well, he's become his own personality, right?
He's not a character anymore. He's just Sam Jackson.
Exactly. Oh, he's so funny, too.
Okay. I love that.
Number 9.
Number 9, like these, oh man, like my list, it was so hard, the later ones.
It is tough.
Number 9, I had to say Daniel Craig as James Bond.
He was on my short list.
Yeah, is a badass. And I said actually in the first one, Casino Royale, in his first.
He does the most.
Because that movie shows his range of a badass. And I think that scene, when he's getting whipped on his balls.
Yeah, I was going to say, from the first chase all the way to the torture scene.
Yeah, when he's getting tortured and he starts laughing. And he's like,
the world's going to know you just scratched my balls.
Little to the right. Boom.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And just like, I was a fan of James Bond growing up. And just I finally seen someone that was, to me, a real badass playing the character. Yeah, that's why he's on my list.
Great. Yeah. Great choice. My number nine is, it's in the vein of Gone Girl. I went with Lisbeth Salander, Girl with Dragon Tattoo.
Oh! Dude! I didn't even think about her!
There it is, man!
Badass.
23 years old, and this, like, tiny, what you would think, a very vulnerable girl, but the way that she turns the whole situation around.
That's a good one! I didn't think of that!
She's, I mean, I adore that movie. I'm getting goosebumps thinking about that movie. Yeah. But her character in it is just, it's, like, in my mind, definition. The way doesn't care what anyone thinks about her, right? And is willing to do whatever it takes. Is smart and is also, like, violent and terrifying. Just that scene where she... I guess spoilers for all these movies, because we got to talk about the great scenes. This where she gets back at the
man that
the
raped
social...
her.
Yeah, the guy who raped her. And says, if you were to go through my whole file, what would it say about me if you were to sum it up? It would say I'm insane. And the guy's like, no. She's like, no, it's true. I am insane. Oh, man.
Boom.
Yeah.
Dude. Oh.
Yeah. Oh. Oh, yo. Yeah, that's my number nine.
That is sweet. She is a badass.
Number eight
on my list.
Yes.
Is an evil badass.
Oh, we got some evil people coming up.
Anthony Hopkins, Silence of the Lambs.
That was one of my possibilities,
Hannibal Lecter. I tell ya, he is a badass. Because he... just the way he twists people's minds and gets into their heads. That's a badass. And it also is because of Anthony Hopkins' performance.
Oh,
it's just...
I think all of these is a big part of it.
It's a huge part of it. But even in the later ones that weren't so acclaimed, Red Dragon and Hannibal, he's still a badass.
Still as scary as ever.
I love it. Yeah.
That's a great choice.
Yes.
I like that too, and I like that we're hitting on, characters who, for other reasons, for more than just, being tough or looking cool on screen.
So we're
He's also physically dangerous.
Oh, yes. He rips off someone's
face.
Tongue.
Yeah.
Oh. He's a cannibal.
Scary.
I'm having an old friend.
My number eight is someone who, in the view of Adolf Hitler, is a real villain. And that's Aldo the Apache, played by Brad Pitt in Glorious Bastards. 100 Nazi scalps! And I want my scalps! Oh, if you watch this movie and you realize who this character is, he's probably my favorite Brad Pitt performance.
Oh, so good.
And he's my favorite character. One of my favorite movies. I think it's 19 on my top 100 in Glorious
Bastards. It's amazing.
And then up until that last scene when they're supposed to deliver Christoph Waltz, like spoilers again, sorry, all of this is spoilers. Red spoilers everywhere.
Yeah.
All these movies. When he's supposed to deliver Christoph Waltz over and boom, they shoot his guy.
And Christoph Waltz is like,
what are you doing? He was supposed to the back and he was supposed to. He's like, yeah, they don't care about him. I might get you down.
I love that.
Are you going to
take out that uniform?
We didn't think. Oh, yeah.
I love it because the audience goes,
Oh shit. And then when he does that and he says, I think this is my masterpiece.
Yeah. I love that movie. What
other movie character is willing to scalp people?
Yeah.
And and just the fact that he's hunting Nazis and everything, he puts him in another level.
I love Brad Pitt. Yeah. the rest of my list is almost like when you think of badass actors.
It's all that.
This is them.
I got a few interesting ones coming up.
Yeah.
But your number seven, let's hear it.
My number seven, one of my favorite actors of all time, Leonardo DiCaprio, Wolf of Wall Street.
What? That's very different.
Yes. I think he is such a badass in that movie. I love cocky characters.
Yeah.
So it's funny. I was looking at, like, characters from Batman and things like that, and I was like, I think Christian Bale as Bruce Wayne is badass. Because that playboy...
But then taking that to another
cocky,
level.
And I think Leonardo character in that is such a badass. Because he has hot wife and a lot of money. And badasses to me, for the most part, don't care about anyone else but
themselves. Don't care about anything else but themselves.
And I think that's what makes him such a badass in that movie. Because all he cares about is money.
I think it's a very interesting pick.
Yeah.
My number 7, another just like murderous, rampaging guy with a knife. And that's Bill the Butcher. Ooh. Daniel Day in Gangs of New York. Here's a character who has his like these honorable rules that he follows in this world.
Yeah.
So he gets beat up by Liam Neeson's priest character. He's telling this story to his son unknowingly. He's talking to him and says how he was so ashamed he couldn't look Liam Neeson's character in the eye. So he said, so I cut the eye that looked away and sent it to him wrapped in blue paper. And he says, I would have took them both out if I could fight him blind. Like, he took his own eye out with a knife and sent it to his enemy. And he waited, and he says, I rose up with a full heart and I buried him in his own blood. Like, just scenes like that. He's such a terrifying villain. And, like, when he gets shot, and he just screams, and when he finds out Leo is the priest's son, and he's just, like, headbutting him, and he's gonna, like, cut out his heart, and, like...
It's badass. I will say, he does appear on my list later on.
Woo!
So, that's our first crossover one.
That's our first crossover. But
Daniel Day, yeah. But when you think about a badass, like, he's played some badasses, but that one, most of all, is just
most me, of all. Is
Bill the Butcher, I tell you.
Number 6.
Number 6 on my list, another sweet badass, Viggo Mortensen, Aragorn.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings.
He almost made my list.
You didn't?
No, I wait till you see what I have coming, but he was close.
Oh, man. Just, when I think of badass, I think of the scene with Palantir.
Yeah.
And him talking to...
the extended edition of Return of the King.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen it, because most people haven't, look up extended scene, Aragorn, Sauron.
Aragorn talks to Sauron.
Behold, the Sword of Elendil.
Oh, and just that final speech.
Yeah. It's so beautiful. It's poetic.
For Frodo. And like, he's such a badass, too, that I think...
Fights all the Nazgul on his own.
I know.
On Weathertop.
And I love that he's a selfless badass.
Mm-hmm.
That he's a badass, but he's a badass because he cares so much about the people.
He's like one of the only heroes.
Yeah, like an actual hero.
My list.
I know. Leonardo DiCaprio, Wolf of Wall Street, Viggo, and Rings. Who's a hero? Okay, what's your 6?
My number 6, we're back to David Fincher. My number 6, and it's Brad Pitt again, Tyler Durden.
He's on my list. He's coming up on my list.
Here's an uncompromising, crazy, doesn't, you know, give a crap about anything.
No.
Well, except for his principles. But, like, I mean, you can beat him to a pulp and he still is working you.
I know.
I mean, just scene after scene of the guy. This
Fight
like,
Club is awesome.
This just unleashed ego. I love his character so much.
He's such a badass. The scene that pops into my mind... Him shirtless, Brad Pitt is ripped, dripping in blood, just like standing, his pants are so
in
far down.
In the basement
down.
Of that bar.
His pants are so far
you
down.
You start to see the angle of his dick.
Yeah, and he just, and everyone loves him. He is such a badass.
That movie
Brad Pitt is just so cool. Oh, he's so cool. Man, he's so cool. I wish...
Tyler
If I had
Durden.
To give a drug to someone to keep them young forever, it'd be Brad Pitt. Seriously, I'm like... Dude, I wish I could keep
not like age. Not like Stephen Hawking
no,
or some like brilliant mind. No, we need Brad Pitt.
We need that body.
We need that. Bring it back.
Okay, we're into our top 5.
Mm-hmm.
Top 5, ladies and gentlemen. My 5 has been discussed before. Daniel Day-Lewis, Gangs of New York, Bill the Butcher.
What else
just
can
amazing.
Be said?
Just amazing.
Well, like one of my favorite scenes in that too that I mentioned before is when he's killed the sheriff.
Yeah.
He's killed John C. Reilly. And so the mayor comes to visit him in this like kitchen area where he's like barely cooking his steak, practically eating it raw. And the mayor says to him like you killed an elected official? And then he says, you don't know what you've done to yourself. And this was improv by Daniel Day. So you don't know what you've done to yourself. He looks up at the mayor, takes the knife, and taps it on his glass eye. Like, I know what I've done to myself. I know what I'm doing. I mean, what?
I bet with an actor like that, Scorsese is just like, just keep rolling.
Just keep going. How could you not?
Amazing. Okay, you're number 5.
My number 5?
There's
going
to be another crossover. I know there is.
I'm curious. I don't know if he's on your list.
I don't know.
His name Maximus Decimus Meridius.
Oh, no. He's so, he was so close.
Gladiator. He's a badass. Dude. I mean, there's a movie that was so influential in my early movie years. Like, that was a part. I think it was on my top 10 for a long time. Gladiator. Russell Crowe wins an Oscar for this movie. And I think deserved.
Yes.
And when you look at that role, that he goes from being this general who's just already a badass.
Yeah.
And then they take his family away. And you have to watch him.
In a brutal way.
And you have to watch him, like, be rebuilt into this man with this singular vision. Like, it was between, like, him or William Wallace. We're like, cool.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, I'll pick only one.
Yeah.
And I picked him. Just because of that final showdown with Joaquin Phoenix.
Boom,
when
boom,
the gladiator punch. Left, back, and right. Yeah. Just for... He stabs him, the coward.
Yeah.
And then facing him, it doesn't matter.
No.
He's just so strong.
And he fights
he's
to the
so
death.
He's so tough.
You know what? I love that movie.
I really love
that movie. When it goes back
Ridley
and the hands in the field.
Guys, Ridley
music.
Scott
not,
is...
Not yet.
Not yet. Not yet.
I haven't watched it in years.
It's worth revisiting, man.
Yeah.
It's
really I think good. I'd really, really like it. Just that part when he's crouching at his wife's feet, who's crucified.
He's just, like, weeping. And he just collapses there.
His little boy and his wife. Oh, what is he? What does Joaquin Phoenix say?
And they ravaged her.
And they ravaged
again,
her.
Again.
And again.
And again.
Oh. You just want Joaquin to be beaten
and
to a pulp.
And then he says, the time for honoring yourself will soon be at an end. Highness.
Oh.
Smile for me, brother.
And of course the
main scene.
The main.
I when he takes
Decimus Meridius. Captain of two
or what is it? General of the Felix Legions.
Father to a murdered son.
Husband
to a murdered wife. And I will have my vengeance.
In this life or the next. Oh! And the look on Joaquin Phoenix's face!
Badass.
Woo! All right, moving on.
Number four. This is the most badass female of all time.
I think it is.
This is the bride.
That's my number five!
Uma Thurman.
Oh, that's my number four. My number four.
Really?
The same
one.
The bride.
Uma
Beatrix
Thurman.
Kiddo. Kill Bill Volume 1 and 2.
We talked about this weeks ago on the podcast. Because we were filming a short film that had like kung fu things. So I was in like a Kill Bill mode. So I watched them both in like the same day.
And dude.
She is the biggest female badass. Like another one that's not on my list. I had two like huge female that I'm like they're both badass. I had Sigourney Weaver as
Ripley
in Alien, and I had Uma Thurman, and I was like, Uma, man, she is just a badass. She has nothing to lose.
She's so great,
and she kills so many people in the most coolest of ways,
just nonstop. Oh.
If you haven't seen Kill Bill Volume 1 and 2,
do yourself a favor. It's
do
on Netflix
favor.
Right now.
And just watch it with an open mind. It is a different
just
movie.
Just get lost in this insanity.
Yeah.
That's on screen. That's great.
That's where number
That was my number four as well. What's your number three?
Brad Pitt, Fight Club.
Ah, Tyler Durden!
Tyler Durden. He is the epitome of cool. Because he doesn't care.
Doesn't care.
He lives in the crappiest apartment. Making soap. The
apartment in a house.
Oh, a house.
His basement
floor.
And
it's a disgusting house. I wonder if our top two are the same.
I don't know. I'm not sure. We'll
okay,
see.
So
we'll
I'll
see
start.
Soon.
My number two.
I haven't done my number three yet.
Oh.
My number three is who I think is actually the most badass female character.
Ooh.
So the bride and this was like, but I'm giving the edge to the one who I think is put in a more dire situation and comes through. And
Nala.
Nala. Just Simba left without even saying goodbye. No. Imperator Furiosa. Charlize Theron and Mad Max Fury
Road.
Yeah,
that was close on my list, yeah.
Oh, dude.
She
just
is
that
a badass.
Just that, the black over her eyes and went, remember me. His face gets ripped off. And then she leads them. She comes back. She almost dies. And she's going to lead
I love that movie. Mad Max is the best movie of the past.
It's like the best action movie ever made.
Yeah. It's beyond... Even my friends who aren't into action movies, like my friend Cameron.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't seen that many, like, movies. Like,
the
ones we talk about.
But he recognized something.
And he's like... He came to me. He was like... Have you ever seen Mad Max? Like,
yeah. Have I
said,
seen Mad Max?
And he was like, I have never seen a movie like that. Ever. Like, it looked like nothing I've ever seen. I'm like...
Dude.
Dude, man.
No, no, oh. you'll see. Okay, but these are the good ones. I think one of us has the same one. Okay, top your number two.
My number two is a hero for all time. Harrison Ford as Indiana Jones.
Yes! And not, I'm so glad
not Han Solo.
Because Indiana Jones is more. He was like number 11 on my
list.
Really? Yes.
Oh, I thought he would be one of your top
two. He was super close, but there's just these other two, they have to take
Harrison Ford as Indiana Jones is just the coolest. Yeah, he is. If you think of an adventure hero,
he's the coolest.
He takes the cake.
He is the coolest.
He's a badass, except for snakes. He's scared of snakes, but don't watch Temple of Doom or Kingdom of the Crystal Skull.
So those two,
just
great,
one and three,
two amazing movies you can enjoy.
Yeah,
yeah, I 100% agree. I like him too because he gets beat up so much.
Oh,
and he keeps coming back.
Yeah.
That's what I like.
And he
about
has such
him.
A humor to him and a charm.
Of course.
He's one of the most charming young actors ever.
I mean, he's great.
Like, and that's I was looking on lists today of, like, for this top 10 characters, blah, blah, blah. And Harrison Ford has created two of the most iconic roles ever.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
That's, yeah. How many other actors have that?
Yeah.
Like, as far as really iconic roles?
Maybe. Closest one is James Earl Jones, Mufasa,
and Darth Vader. But even that, like...
One's animated.
I agree that Harrison Ford, those two characters, he's given so much.
Yep. Okay.
My number two, I'm just sad because I know you haven't really seen these movies, but he is the definition of the American badass.
Bradley Cooper, American
Related to Clint Eastwood, it's the man with no name...
So it's Clint Eastwood. Yeah, yeah.
The good, the bad, and the ugly for a few dollars more and a fistful of dollars.
Yeah.
In most of his westerns, but even in Unforgiven.
Yeah.
But in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, this man is so cool and he's so calm and he barely speaks and he's the quickest draw and he's so clever in these movies. They're like in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. In the first two movies, he's always wearing this poncho. And in the third one, he doesn't have a poncho for most of it. And all this stuff goes down. It's a long movie, but it's brilliant. And then leading up to the final thing.
What one?
The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
Oh, yeah, I've seen it.
You have seen it?
Oh, so yeah, in, like, multiple times.
I can't remember. So in the last act, when they're like leading up to this graveyard where they're going to try and find the treasure, he shoots that cannon at the guy or whatever. But so he goes into this like this burnt out Civil War kind of fort, and he finds a poncho. And he whips it on, and then like the music gets going. And I mean, he is just... He represents the American badass, a cowboy. And
yes.
I needed a cowboy on my list.
Yeah.
He's my number two.
Amazing. Our top...
Number one? I think we might have the exact same number one. I'm curious. I'm really curious.
Well, let me tell you, when we decided this was going to be the theme of this week, there was never any question. As soon as we said badass, I wrote down this name. And
this number one is the first one I wrote down.
Yeah, this was like...
I'm so curious.
Badass.
I'm scared because, like, I just don't know.
Yeah, I was like, this is single greatest badass.
Okay, you go. Tell me.
Okay? Come on. Robert De Niro, Godfather 2.
But right there, The Godfather.
Yeah.
Part 1 and Part 2.
Yeah.
Oh, Don Vito.
Don Vito. In both, but especially Robert De Niro.
I'm so scared you isn't Batman.
No.
Oh.
No.
It's The Godfather.
Batman was so... Like, let's talk about Godfather first, then I'll go into
it's
that.
It's The Godfather.
It is. But especially for me, when I think of a badass, I think of De Niro in that first scene. When he's sitting there, and he leans over, and he talks in Italian. I'm like...
Just right
he
away.
He is so calm. And when you watch Robert De Niro think in that movie, oh, this is how it works. This is how I'm going to do this.
Yeah, exactly.
This is what
exactly.
I'm going to do. It's all calculated.
Oh.
And how everyone around him... is like not as smart as he is, but he's thinking about the future. And when you see that play out in the first movie,
don't worry about it. I take care of everything.
He's such a badass. Robert De Niro.
That first in that assassination when he kills the Black Hand, the guy?
Yeah.
The light bulb?
Yeah.
And he's standing there with the towel around the gun.
Say goodbye. And I love when he goes and kills his father's killer.
Say goodbye. Oh!
When he says his name?
Oh, what is it? Antonio. Or what is it?
Cuts
Antolini.
His stomach.
Vito Andolini. Oh, and you feel it too.
Yeah.
Oh, so freaky.
Robert De Niro is so cool. I was going to say, you know what? I wrote down Bane, Batman, Joker, and I couldn't find... when you think of badass, I was like...
find its way
I was like, the Joker is one of the best characters of all time, but he's not a badass to me.
Not the same. Like, no. I would put him in the same category as Tyler Durden, but we get to explore Tyler Durden more and in different ways. And he seems like a human. The Joker doesn't seem like a human being. He seems like a force of nature.
Exactly.
What a great list.
Those are two great lists.
Let's quickly run them down. My number 10 was Jules from Pulp Fiction.
Mine was Rosamund Pike, Gone Girl.
I had number 9, Lisbeth Salander.
James Bond in Casino Royale.
Aldo the Apache.
Anthony Hopkins, Silence of the Lambs.
Bill the Butcher.
Leonardo, Wolf of Wall Street.
Daniel Day. Or what am I saying? I'm reading the wrong thing. Tyler Durden.
Aragorn, Lord of the Rings.
Maximus.
Daniel Day, Gangs of New York.
The Bride.
The Bride.
Furiosa.
Tyler Durden, Fight Club.
The Man with No Name.
Indiana Jones.
And Don Vito.
Don Vito Corleone.
Those are the best.
Those are the best.
Now, like, comment below.
Yeah.
Your favorites and why. I want to hear this.
Like, there are some huge ones that I know. Like, Ripley is a badass.
She was on my
William
list.
Wallace.
She on my list.
Massive.
I had Steve McQueen in Bullet. He's so... And I also had Gene Hackman as Popeye in The French Connection.
Oh, yeah. I had Mufasa from Lion King. I think he's a badass.
You have to be.
I almost thought, to
be King of the Pride.
Yeah, and when he dies, I'm like, you're still a badass. You know who's not? Simba.
Not at all.
He's such a baby. And why does he call Timon Timon? Everyone else. And that's what I don't understand. Why didn't the director go, Matthew Broderick? Everyone's saying Timon. So you got to say Timon. Timon.
Oh, Timon. Okay.
You know what's so random? How Matthew Broderick is in Manchester by the Sea.
Oh, yeah. As the weird new husband.
Yeah.
But great casting.
Yeah.
Super
great
awkward.
Casting. All right. Let's do our new segment. Who would win in a fight?
Head to head.
Head to head.
We each have 3 different fight scenarios.
Yes.
We're going to...
out of badasses.
We're each going to pick... we each are going to present a fight. We're going to then decide... either of us will decide who would win.
Okay.
If we have different ideas, we have to fight it out.
Okay.
My number one... some of these are like iconic ones.
Okay, okay.
My number one, William Wallace versus Maximus. Who would win? Okay, we'll pick on 3. 1, 2, 3.
William Wallace.
He's a trained military...
same with William Wallace.
No, he isn't.
Yes.
No, he's not like, well, not
you know,
really.
You know what I thought? The reason he I said that like... is I think Maximus is not as crazy as William Wallace is.
That's a good point.
The problem is Maximus is a monster. Maximus had so much to fight in him because of revenge from his wife and
so
I know that started
so
off
if he wasn't
William Wallace.
Seeking revenge.
Yeah, I don't know.
I guess it would depend on the circumstance. I think it would be
William Wallace has a pet dragon. Flies it. No. No. That is a hard one. I almost said Maximus, but I just think William Wallace has that...
that wild man, you're
that
right.
That wild man that he's like, I don't care.
But then again, Maximus in that first fight, right?
Yeah.
When he's fighting the Germans.
Yeah.
And then he's about to stab his friend, and he sees his friend, and he smiles. He's got this bloodlust in him, you know?
Yeah.
Or if you put them in the Colosseum... and it's the two fighting against each other. What I like about Maximus for the... but I disagree with you a little bit. Because Maximus, when he's fighting the Colosseum, he doesn't care.
Yeah.
He says, I might die in the arena tomorrow. He's got this, like, whatever kind of thing about him. Whereas William Wallace is fighting for his country. He wouldn't want to die.
Yeah.
I think Maximus would just...
like, is this taking all the circumstances out? And there's just two...
I don't know. That's part of the fun
or
of the
or what
debate.
If it's... if you win, you get your freedom. And if you win, you get your wife and son
both
back.
Of them. Both of them.
William
you get
Wallace,
your,
you
wife,
get your back.
Wife back.
And they have both of them
okay.
up there.
It's who gets their wife back? I think it goes to Maximus.
I think they both just kill each other. Like
they
die
simultaneously.
It would just be like brutal. Oh, that's a good one. Okay, mine.
Your first head-to-head? Let's hear it.
Ripley or the Bride?
Oh, okay. Well, we gotta count it down.
Yeah.
All right.
This one's too easy.
3, 2, 1.
The bride.
Just cut her up.
Yeah.
Just cut her head off.
But Ripley has an alien who thinks she's the mom. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Later in the aliens.
Yeah.
But you can't do that.
I know.
Because, yeah.
I know. But Ripley has a gun.
the bride has a gun, too. She's
okay.
An assassin. All right. My next one also has the bride.
Yeah.
Who would win in a fight? The bride or Batman? All right, ready? 3, 2, 1.
Batman.
I agree. Because how could... Come on! How could he lose?
Yeah.
How could he lose?
Yeah.
She'd throw down some smoke bomb.
Yeah.
Taser her or something. Yeah. But he wouldn't kill her.
No.
That's what's great about Batman 2, is like when you watch The Dark Knight, the how incredible that scene is in the building is it's not like he just beats up all the guards. He like gets them all out of the way.
Yes.
And safe.
Yeah.
At the same time.
You
know, he's too smart.
Oh.
He's too smart.
And that's what I loved about Dark Knight Returns, reading it again, is he still has that rule.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's why Batman v Superman makes no sense.
Because he's broken that why rule does over he, and over again.
All of a sudden, kill everyone.
Don't like
that
it.
That defeats the purpose of Batman.
Don't like
and
it.
And they don't even comment on it.
Don't like it.
It's stupid. All right, mine.
Your final showdown.
No,
oh,
I have two
mind.
More.
Okay, sorry. How many did you do?
Three?
I did three.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah, sorry, okay. Go ahead.
Aragorn,
mm-hmm.
a.k.a. Strider, versus Bill the Butcher.
Okay. 3, 2, 1.
Aragorn.
Yep.
Yeah.
Bow and arrow. That's what I was thinking. Just from far away.
But Bill
away.
The Butcher would be... He has more of an edge to him than Aragorn.
He's really
he
scary.
He would be a threat.
I agree.
If it was sword with axes... I think
it would
be.
It could be close.
I think it'd be bloody. I think it'd be pretty bad. Because Aragorn.
Aragorn's just. He's like 80. He's lived through so many wars.
But he doesn't. He's so used to killing
think
orcs,
about
though.
It. But he's fighting Lurtz.
Yeah.
Which is like a gorilla of a monster, and he still beats him.
I know.
I think it would be a similar sort of showdown. I think he'd get hurt. I think Bill would get at his like hamstrings or something to be able
but
to cut
Aragorn,
something up.
Yeah.
That would be a crazy thing to see, eh?
Yeah. Yeah. The nerds in this. Darth Vader versus anyone.
Darth Vader versus everyone.
Oh, that's funny. Okay, my last one is one that I believe has been, I don't know if we've debated it, but has been debated for a long time already.
I'm excited.
It's two huge action stars.
Boom.
James Bond versus Jason Bourne. 3, 2, 1.
Jason Bourne.
James Bond's a drunk.
Hands down, Jason Bourne.
James Bond's a drunk. It'll
Jason
slow him
Bourne
down.
Jason Bourne never dealt with like drugs or alcohol. He's too... Yeah, Jason Bourne.
He's too quick.
Just watch
and too resourceful.
Yeah.
Now, like, Casino Royale tried to make Daniel Craig into, like, Bourne.
Yeah.
So if you took, if you took Bourne Ultimatum Bourne
versus Casino Royale,
that would be close.
Yes.
But I think that Jason Bourne would find, like, he would find,
oh, that would be such a good
fight. See
what
I mean? He would find, like, some tiny little thing, and he would take, like, the cap off of this and, like,
shove
it in Daniel Craig's eye.
How crazy would it have been if those two companies decided to come together?
A crossover movie. They're two different.
And those two fought. That'd be stupid. That's better than anything
else. I still think Jason Bourne takes it. Yes. I think Jason Bourne takes it.
Okay. My last one is another huge one.
All right. I'm ready.
Flynn Rider versus
who?
Flynn Rider
from Tangled
versus John Smith from Pocahontas.
Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1.
John Smith.
Absolutely. Flynn Rider is nothing but a thief.
And he has...
John Smith is a warrior.
And he has all the Native Americans on his side. Like, seriously. Flynn's a dummy.
It's like you set that up just to bash... Just to bash how stupid Finn is.
I know. Flynn, not
Flynn. Flynn. Oh, that was fun.
That was fun. Badasses, guys.
They work so well in movies because...
You know who aren't badasses? Me and you.
Not at all, man.
No. We're nice. We're nice asses.
I'm too nice. I would try and, like, deceive someone before trying to kill them. Like, I'll try and be sneaky.
I'm more of a Vito Corleone. That's what we are kind of like.
More
we're,
like that.
We're calculating.
Yeah, that's true.
We're
that's
not like true. A Bruce Willis.
Or like some Bill the Butcher psychopath.
Yeah,
like,
yet.
Like in high school, there were these guys that were super tough. I don't want to name them because I'm scared of them still.
Yeah.
And in high school, I never got into fights. I was never on anyone's bad side. But one day, this one guy, because I knew him when we were kids... And we had, like, mutual friends, and we'd see each other quite a bit. He pulled me over, and he said, anybody messes with you, tell them that you're my friend. And I was like, okay, we're friends. And I feel like somehow I was protected by this name, because he was so scary.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
No, you'll tell me after. Oh, yeah.
Man. scary guys. Just like dead eyes.
Oh, yeah.
Because they actually had like some vision issues.
Yeah.
So their eyes were always open more and just jacked. GSP.
And I'll never forget. I've only seen one actual fight in person. And I was in high school and everyone knew it was happening this lunch.
Oh, yeah.
And there was one guy walking around. And I was like here. And he was walking around. And this guy came with headphones blasting down the steps. With this look of craze in his eye, ran, jumped on this other guy, started pounding him in the face.
Jumping on his back.
The other guy takes him and is crushing his ribs as hard as he can. Just as hard as he's taking blows to the face, just crushing his ribs as hard as he can. It was not fun. I didn't like it. I was like, this is scary.
Like, I only yelled kill him like 4 or 5 times before starting to lose him. It's distasteful. Yeah.
Then one guy came in and shot them both.
And his name was Lutrache.
Lutrache.
No. Now, I don't know if I've ever... I don't think I've ever seen a real fight in person. I mean, I love MMA.
Yeah.
Those guys. Badasses.
Badasses. Wow. Did you like this podcast? Do you like badasses? Do you like film? Do you like movies?
Did you like my lamp? Jake? Did you bring me here? Yeah. Do you know Aladdin?
Yeah.
Did you rub my lamp?
Did you give me a
then
wish?
Like us. Like this video. Subscribe, comment,
share. Please share. If you like these podcasts, I urge you to watch the videos we have on MOVI. They're awesome so far. And the reason I can say that is Jake makes most of them. So I'm not being cocky. I just think they're awesome.
And we have a lot of great stuff coming up. With every new movie coming in theaters, we got something topical and interesting for you to see.
Tune in. Oh, no, you'll have already listened to it.
Go watch our Logan review and comment below and tell
us. Because where it starts in 3 hours and 40 minutes.
That's all the time we have to kill. Let's do another podcast.
Yeah. Bunk, 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 bunk. We shouldn't even have a theme music anymore.
It should just cut away.
It should just be, what is it? Bow and now. Now and now.
You mean.
I'm trying to remember.
You mean ba da 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 ba ba da 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 da. What song are you talking
about? No, I'm talking about our podcast theme song.
What is the song you're doing, though?
Welcome to the Luke and Jake Movie Podcast.
You're trying to...
It's a hard one to sing. It
da,
is.
Da 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 da.
See, that da, 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 da.
That's the song. You're doing it too slow. Beat it up.
I don't know.
Watching MOVI!